Hey everyone, and welcome to the Ultimate Job Search and Career Podcast. I am Bill Todd, the company's expert. I will be your host today. And in today's episode, we're going to be talking about being the safe candidate or the star candidate. Which one should you be in a job interview? We're going to be getting into that, as well as should you bring notes to a job interview and use them as a reference? We're going to be getting into that too. In fact, today, I'm going to be answering five questions that have been sent in by my awesome viewers and listeners. You guys are great. Thank you very much. It's great to get intelligent questions. But I try and open these things on a lighter note. And I just want to say that in my neighborhood, where there are houses, people usually have fences around their property. And some people put signs that say, beware of dog, on the fence. And I thought it would be funny if I put up a sign that said, beware of fence. I need my own sound effects. Then I can give it this wah, wah, wah. I'm going to do my own sound effects from now on. Anyway, tell me in the comments if you thought that was funny or I should not quit my day job. Here we go. Let's get into the first question here. This was sent in by someone called Florida Highwayman. Florida Highwayman says, in the course, you talk about memorizing answers to traditional and behavioral questions, but I have a couple of questions about that. Number one, during a Zoom interview, how much would you recommend going off notes? Would it be okay to have star bullet points for each story you have, or to reference them every time a question is asked, or would that be too much? So that's the first question that Florida Highwayman asks. And then he says, number two, if you have all your answers and stories memorized, how can you mitigate the risk of sounding like you're reciting them versus telling them naturally? Okay, excellent question, Florida Highwayman. And I think right off the hop, I'm going to first of all have to thank you for taking my course. Many people have taken my course called Get Hired, where I walk you through absolutely everything that I would recommend for how to get a job. And a lot of people have said nice things about it. So thank you very much for taking that. I'm glad it's working out for you. Now, to answer your questions, you got two questions here. The first one is, how much would you recommend going off notes? Would it be okay to have star bullet points for each story and reference them? Or would it be too much? Short answer is yes. Okay, it would be too much. This is where preparation for a job interview comes into play. You really should have all your stories memorized. Okay, now when I say stories, this was in reference to behavioral questions. Behavioral questions are any question they ask you where you have to answer with a story. Like, tell me about a time you resolved a conflict. Tell me about a time you went above and beyond. Tell me about a time you disagreed with your boss. How did you handle it? Those are examples of behavioral questions. And in order to answer those, You're going to be telling a story about something from your past. You know, you're going to tell them about a time that you had a conflict with your boss. Now, the standard way of answering those questions was to answer in this STAR format, STAR, situation, task, action, result. Okay. Now, what I think is helpful is if you're on a Zoom call, like Florida Highwayman is asking, or you're in a traditional face-to-face job interview, it can be handy to have on a piece of paper or something in front of you, something that says STAR, situation, task, action, result, just to kind of keep you on topic when you're telling your story, okay? So you look down at your paper for a second, and you're not reading a story off your paper, but it says situation. So you go, okay, this was 2 years ago. My boss had asked me to do this task and I disagreed with him. And then you look down task. He expected me to do this particular job in a certain way. It wasn't the way I would have liked to do it, but it was the way that he personally wanted it done. But I felt it was inefficient. Action. I look down, I see action. What did I do? Okay, well, I chose to do it my way because I was very confident that I would get much better results. And I chose not to not to advance the information that I did this my way instead of his way. And then I looked down at my paper result. Oh, how it turned out. And what happened was I did it my way. I kept it a secret that I did it my way. My boss was very impressed with the results. And after he commended me for the results, I then volunteered that I did it my way instead of his way. And, you know, said, is that okay if I continue doing it this way in the future? And my boss said, you know what? That's fine. And that's how I handled it. You know, I'm just making this off the top of my head, but I would not read the story off notes. Okay. That's something that you should have memorized. You should know your own stories and have rehearsed them a few times. Okay. But when you're in the interview and you're in the heat of the moment, and sometimes you're nervous and you can't really think off the cuff, the notes should be something that you can quickly glance at just to sort of give you a starting point or a topic, you know, something like that very briefly. You do not want to be reading notes in a job interview, especially reading, you know, something word for word off a page. That is a big red flag, I'm afraid. That tends to communicate that you can't speak extemporaneously, meaning off the cuff. And that could suggest that, you know, there's a problem, because after all, if these stories happen to you, you should be able to remember them. You know, so that would be my take on this. Okay. Now, if you have some kind of mitigating issue, okay, if you have like if you're on the autism spectrum, or you have like anxiety issues or something, there may be exceptions to this, but all things being equal, I would say that would be the appropriate use of notes. Okay. So that's the answer to part one of your question. Part two was, if you have your stories memorized, how can you mitigate the risk of sounding like you're reciting them versus telling them naturally? Well, here's the deal. You should have the story memorized, okay? But you're not going to memorize the exact words that you tell the story in, okay? And you're going to be adapting your story depending on what question they ask you, okay? So, you know, it's not like you're reciting a text that has been pre-planned. Okay, the ideas have been rehearsed, but the exact words that you say will come out off the cuff in a conversational style, and they should not be memorized, they should not be pre-planned, because if they are, if you've gone to great lengths to like memorize a speech or something, you know, people can usually tell that, and it sets off the same alarm bells that I described 30 seconds ago, where, you know, people find that strange, because if you're telling a story about you, you know, there's no reason to have memorized it. It should be a part of your memory, and you should be able to relate it in a intelligible way in a conversation. And if you can't do that, that signals that something is off. Okay. So that's what I would say. You memorize the stories in the sense that you rehearse them a few times, but you will be adapting your stories to whatever question they ask you. And for those of you who don't really know what I'm talking about when I say stories, these are, you know, what I recommend is you memorize or pre-plan 5 success stories, 5 of your greatest accomplishments, and 5 other stories, usually failure stories, you know, how you dealt with a difficult situation, how you overcame a challenge, you know, things like this, how you handled communication issues or conflicts with other people, disagreements with your boss. These should be things that you have planned out in head and you've rehearsed them, not because you need to rehearse things you already know, but because you have practiced saying them in a compact, intelligible way. If they ask you to tell a story and you start a story that would take 10 minutes to finish, that's a problem. You need to be able to tell your story in well under 2 minutes. Okay. Preferably under 1 minute if you can, because then you do the start, the middle, and the end all in a compact way, It's not so long that people lose interest and they have to interrupt you to get to the next question. Okay, so that's the purpose for rehearsing them. Also, if they put you on the spot and you can't think of anything, like a lot of us can't think of things in the moment when we got, you know, several people staring at us and it's a high pressure situation. That's where we rely on our training, having rehearsed these. And so they instantly pop to mind, and then you know exactly how you're going to answer the question. Okay, you just pull out that story and you adapt it to the specific thing that they're asking you. So for example, if they said, tell me about a time you had a conflict with a boss, with your boss, you could tell the story. If they asked you, tell me about a time that you exhibited innovative behavior to impress your boss, you could also pull out this story, okay, about the story about how you did it your way instead of your boss's way. That story can be an answer to many different questions. So if you come equipped to a job interview with 10 stories rehearsed and on the tip of your mind, you're pretty prepared for any kind of behavioral question they throw at you, okay? But don't be reading it off a piece of paper, okay? That's what the rehearsal time is for. And anyone that's going on a job search to prepare you for job interviews, you should be doing some rehearsal for it, some practice, so that you are much better prepared. Okay, so I know that was a bit long-winded, but hopefully that answers Florida Highwayman's two questions there. Thank you for sending that in, and thank you for taking my course. You're awesome. Okay, moving on. Now we have a question here from Louis Dorado, if I'm saying that correctly. Louis Dorado or Louis Dorado. And Louis has this big long question, but I'm just going to read the relevant question here. He says, I wonder if it's good to make it appear that candidates are not as reachable and make it a bit more difficult to be approachable. I think it makes a candidate more desirable to be obtained for the interview, but I could be wrong. Basically, what Louis is asking, at least my interpretation of it, is it okay to play hard to get? Does that signal that you are a person who's highly in demand, highly competent, and that as a result, you indirectly signal that you're very successful and you're a very desirable candidate? And if being unavailable and not returning messaging immediately, is that a way of playing hard to get, as it were, to a recruiter? And is that a good thing? Here's the deal. Louis, that's a great question. That may work possibly, arguably, in maybe personal relationships or something, but unfortunately, generally speaking, that does not work with recruiters, certainly, and it does not work with hiring managers, because here's the deal. It doesn't matter how in demand you are and how professional you are, people make time for the things in which they're interested. Okay, so you could be a highly in-demand person, and maybe you're impossible to get hold of, you know, for some people. But if you are enthusiastic about a certain, role or position with a company, you will return the recruiter's calls, and you will respond to communication about it, okay? So here's the problem. If you kind of play hard to get, you don't respond to voicemails or emails or messaging immediately, or put it this way, if you don't respond within, say, 24 hours, which is a reasonable amount of time, that signals that you're not interested in the job. And that will be usually interpreted as a red flag. Okay, so doing this, I understand where you're coming from, but no, I would say this is not a good thing to do, okay, because that's an immediate turnoff. You're signaling I'm not interested, and the reality is that no matter how brilliant you are and no matter how valuable or in demand you are, if you're not interested in their job, then you are a non-starter, okay? You could be Albert Einstein. You could be absolutely brilliant, but if you just don't want to do the job, you're not going to be much use to that organization. And because you won't do the job. So they feel they're getting a taste of that before they've even looked at you further. Okay. So I would not do this. Now, like everything, like every recommendation, there's always exceptions. There's all kinds of interesting and odd things that happen out in the world. But all things being equal, this is how it goes. Okay. But you make a great question that no one's ever asked me that before. So way to go, Louis Dorado. Thank you very much for sending that in. That's awesome. Okay. Moving on. That's two questions. Let's go to the third. Now, here we have a very short question. This is from somebody called, if I'm saying this right, Voconathum. Voconathum? I thought it was Vogon Anthem, but it's not. Voconathum. Anyway, as always, I'm sure I'm saying it wrong. I say everything wrong. You know, I can mispronounce my own name in front of important people, and that's fine. I'm okay with that. It's who I am, and I refuse to apologize for it. Voconathum says, should I be the star candidate or safe candidate in an interview? Excellent question. Should you be the star candidate or the safe candidate in an interview? Well, here's the deal. Here's the short answer. If you're dealing with a recruiter, you should be the safe candidate. If you're dealing with a hiring manager, you should be the star candidate. Okay. Now, as I said, there's always exceptions to this, but let me explain. Okay. First of all, the hiring manager is the person that if you get the job, they're your boss. Okay. So that's the role of a hiring manager. They don't work in HR. They're the person that is selecting who's going to be the new person that will report to them. Okay. The recruiter, on the other hand, works for HR, and they only deal with recruiting. So what that means is their job is to find people with a certain skill set and post a job and, you know, receive applications, filter the applications, make short lists of people, perhaps do first round interviews with those candidates, do background checks, check references, schedule interviews, okay? And that's their job. They themselves don't know anything really about the jobs they're recruiting for. For example, if you're a fully qualified and certified accountant and you're applying for an accounting job, and you're dealing with a recruiter, the recruiter will work for HR. They will know nothing about accounting, okay? They are going to verify that you are a fully competent accountant, and your soft skills are fine, and you know, you're not crazy, you're not you know, a criminal, you're not like a complete flake, you're not unreliable, all that kind of stuff. That's what their job is. But when it comes to assessing your accounting skills, the recruiter is ill-equipped to do that. So usually that's when you talk to a hiring manager who is an accountant. They are probably the chief accountant. And they will make the final decision on which person gets the job. And then whoever that person is that's selected, they will report to that hiring manager who is the chief accountant. Okay, so those are the two roles and what they are. Now, usually in a first round interview, okay, if you're going in through standard channels, if you're responding to a job ad and you have sent in your application and you've been asked to come in for an interview, okay, it's always a good idea to try and find out who you're going to be talking to. Okay, are you talking to a recruiter? Are you talking to the hiring manager? Are you talking to the owner of the company? It really helps knowing who you're talking to, because that way you can tailor what you're going to say to make a good impression for them. These people are looking for different things. Now, recruiters, okay, they are paid to come up with candidates who meet a list of job requirements. That's their job. And if they're an independent recruiter, they only get paid when they provide candidates that meet the specifications and are hired and they work out. Okay. I'm really oversimplifying things, but that's basically what they do. Okay. Now, if they presented a hiring manager with a list of clients, the hiring manager picked one of those clients, and it turns out that candidate was a when I don't mean client, I mean candidate. They present the hiring manager with a list of candidates, and the hiring manager selects a candidate, hires them, and it turns out that they're no good. That's a reflection a lot of times on the recruiter. The hiring manager will say, like, what, like, who are these people that you're telling me would be candidates for this job? You know, these people, this one didn't work out at all. It turns out everything on their resume was a lie. It turns out they're completely unreliable. I mean, don't you check this stuff? You know, it's a reflection on the recruiter if there's something wrong with the candidates. So for that reason, recruiters like the safe candidate. Okay. They like a candidate that that is low risk. Okay. So what that means is that they are a perfect match for all the stated job requirements. Okay. They have no things about them that could potentially be a problem. For example, having an employment gap. Okay. If you have an employment gap in your resume, but, you know, say you haven't, your last job, you left it 5 years ago and you've been out of work ever since. They don't like that. They will see that as making you a high risk candidate because there could be a reason why you haven't been working for the last 5 years. Maybe there's something seriously wrong with you. They don't know. So they will perceive that as a red flag and they will label you a high risk candidate. And they will tend to not advance you to the next stage of the selection process where you interview with a hiring manager. Because if ever they picked you and you didn't work out, it would come back to the recruiter and someone would say, well, look, you presented this candidate. They had a 5-year work gap. You know, it turns out the person that you selected, they were in prison for the last 5 years. They didn't disclose this. We didn't find out about it. And you know what? They did something completely inappropriate and took off, you know, and quit. And that's not a good reflection on your recruiting skills. So for that reason, recruiters want the safe candidate. Now, if you're interviewing with a hiring manager, on the other hand, a hiring manager is somebody who is, in our example, they were the chief accountant, okay? They want someone awesome, okay? They don't necessarily want the lowest common denominator in an employee. They don't want someone who's, you know, pure vanilla, no initiative, no character. They are looking, at least depending on the culture of the organization that they work in, they're looking for someone who's going to be a superstar. Okay. Generally speaking, there are exceptions to this, but that's generally how they think. I'm looking for an amazing candidate. Are they a little unconventional? That's fine. But I'm looking for somebody awesome, someone who can bring something to the role, you know? So for that reason, if you're interviewing with a hiring manager, it may be okay to highlight the aspects of yourself that perhaps paint you as a star candidate, as an overachiever. Prioritize that above being conventional and safe. Whereas if you're dealing with a recruiter, generally speaking, safe candidate might be the best choice when you don't really know anything more about these people that you're talking to. Okay. So that would be my recommendation for this. Now, obviously, there's going to be exceptions. I mean, it's hard to give advice that's universally true in every possible situation across every industry, every size company, from startups to enterprise. It's really hard to do that. So there might be exceptions, but if you're going in blind, this would be my advice. Okay, so very special thanks to Voconathum for sending that in. Thank you very much. Great question. Okay, so here we go. Question 4. Now, here's something sent in by someone called Miranda Wenzel. Miranda Wenzel, and that name seems vaguely familiar to me. I'm not sure if you sent in something else, maybe in the past, but Miranda asks, hi, what if my boss wants to promote me, but he's on his way out the, if you see what I'm saying, what if my boss wants to promote me, but he's on his way out of the company? If I fail at the job, who vouches for me? Now, this was a question that was sent in on, I think it was the last episode that I posted on my main channel called Should You Ask for a Raise and Earning the Promotion. Now, here's the deal. Okay. A standard interview question for managers. Okay. Just like for a lot of workers, they're asking you, you know, what are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? Where do you expect to be in 5 years? You know, a standard interview question for managers, especially people managers, is give me an example where you have successfully managed a team that you inherited. Okay. And the reason they ask this question is because it's really not hard to manage a group of people when you get to select the people, right? You tend to select people that you get along with and that are like you. They, you know, they're in their attitudes and work habits and approach, you know. But what can be a real challenge is managing a team of people where you didn't get to pick the people. Somebody else picked them, and now you're in charge of it. Okay. So that would be the situation that Miranda is describing here. Okay. And so she's talking about that. So in theory, a good manager should be able to manage you. Even if you were just promoted, they sort of promoted you while they were halfway out the door, and then you had to deal with their successor. And, you know, you might be nervous because you've just been given this job and now you're having to make a first impression to a new boss. Okay. In theory, they should be okay with that. They should know how to handle it. However, in practice, it's a little bit different. People really fall short of the ideal in reality. And a lot of people just are not very good at managing a team that they didn't select. Okay. And so you could have problems. Now, another thing I want to say is that you seem to be worried about if you fail at the job. Okay. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say, I suspect that you're coming from a large organization. In larger organizations, people tend to be, their priority one is not getting blamed for something. Okay. In smaller companies, small business, startups and, you know, things like this, that tends to not be priority one. They care less about being blamed for something. They care more about just getting results. But in larger organizations, you usually find buildings full of people who spend all day in offices sending emails to each other, and they're just paranoid about essentially covering their ass, having documented evidence of every decision they ever made, every request and instruction they were given, so that they can justify themselves if someone accuses them of something, like screwing something up or being incompetent. You can always say, oh, it wasn't my decision, it was his. Okay, so I could be wrong, but that's, if I had to guess, I'd say you're coming from that kind of environment. Okay, you're worried about failing. Who would vouch for me? First of all, I want to say, don't be afraid of failing. Okay. If you get a promotion and you deserve the promotion, you shouldn't really be worried about failing. Okay. Everyone's a little nervous about doing new things, which is fine. But if you're really worried that, you know, oh my God, I can't do this job, I need training, I need a year to figure this out, I don't know what I'm doing, if you really feel like that and it's a problem, maybe you were promoted too soon. I'm just going to throw that out. Okay. In which case, if you underperform, this might not be much consolation, but it's not your fault. Okay. This should have been, your boss should have promoted you only if you were ready. You don't want to promote someone before they know what they're doing, and then they fail spectacularly and get fired or something. You don't have to worry about that. Okay. But if you're going to be promoted, you know, it's very tempting to take the money and take the title and all the other rewards. But if your boss is halfway out the door when they're doing this for you, the big concern, and rightly so, might be like, you know, is someone going to train me? I mean, if I can't shadow you and learn from you because you're leaving, and I'm going to get your successor and we don't know who the successor is, I'm worried that I might not be trained in time to really make a good impression. So this is something that, if possible, I would address in advance. If your boss is leaving, you could address this with your boss's boss. You don't have to take up too much of their time. You just have to make them aware of this and say, look, you know, no big issue, but I just want to make you aware that I'm just moving into this role and I'm given to understand that my boss is leaving and I'm going to be, you guys are hiring a replacement from outside the organization. And I have some concerns that they're going to form a first impression of me right when I've, you know, I'm undergoing the learning curve for the role. In order to ensure success for myself and therefore everyone else, I'm hoping that there's a plan where I can be trained, because normally I'd be trained by my boss, but they're leaving. So I'm hoping an alternative plan can be made. I at least want to make you aware of this. In addition to asking if we could bring this up with my boss's replacement and see if we can get a plan in place for that. Okay. So being proactive and saying that usually can help. Okay, so that's what I recommend, Marinda. I was going to call you Miranda, but it's Marinda. Way to go. Okay, and the last part of your question, which was who vouches for me, I don't think anyone is going to vouch for you, but that's okay. You just have to understand that you have to vouch for yourself, okay? You're going to have a new boss. It's going to be a blank slate. You want to either make a good first impression or you want to, you know, welcome them and say, like, just so you understand, I just moved into this role and I'm just starting the training for it. So, you know, please keep that in mind and then we can both succeed together. And that's what I want. Okay. So no one's going to vouch for you. You're going to have to vouch for yourself. You're going to have to make sure that there's a plan in place to help you be a success. Okay. That would be my recommendation. Without knowing your details, the details of the organization or, you know, the industry or anything, it's kind of hard for me to be more specific than that, but that's kind of a general approach. So thanks very much to Marinda Wenzel for sending that in. Thanks, Marinda. You're awesome. And it's a great question. Okay. And now we move on to, I believe this is 5 out of 5. 5 out of 5. This is an unusual question because this comes from Twitter. I have an absolutely minimal presence on Twitter. I occasionally post, you know, the videos when they come out. But this is from Darren. Darren at Desation. Desation. Darren at Desation. And Darren says, hey, Bill, here's an odd one for you. I recently accepted an internal secondment, but don't feel it's right for me any longer. From a recruitment perspective, what's a reasonable time frame on confirming the job is right versus leaving? Okay. That's an excellent question. Now, you've recently accepted an internal secondment. Now, my understanding is a secondment is usually, it implies it's temporary. Okay, so this is like you've been assigned to a team or something, like a sort of maybe a cross-functional team, and it's a temporary thing. Maybe you're working on a project, and then when the project ends, it'll be disbanded. I'm assuming that's kind of what you're talking about, but you've decided that you really don't like it. Okay, now from a recruitment perspective, what's a reasonable time frame to confirm the job is right versus leaving? So you're wanting to leave, but perhaps you're maybe a bit scared that if you do leave, it's going to reflect badly on you, on your resume. That's how I'm reading this. If you're talking about from a recruitment perspective. Okay. Now here's the deal. A couple of things here. If indeed this is a temporary assignment, and when they say temporary, they mean less than a year. Okay. And if this is not an emergency, I mean, you don't like it, but it's not like you're undergoing serious psychological trauma, you know, engaging in this secondment. Okay. That's the assumption I'm making. If it is, then of course, everything stops. You've got to take care of yourself first. But assuming, you know, even though you don't like it, even though it's not really your cup of tea, but you can tolerate it and the secondment is temporary and it's less than a year, I would say stick it out. And the reason I say that, okay, the reason I say that is because, how can I put this? A job is, this is maybe a, it's not exactly a modern attitude, but a job is really not meant to be fun all the time. I know you know this. That's why we're paid to do things, right? It's not really, it's not going to be fun all the time. And occasionally, to be a professional, you have to tolerate doing a few things that you don't like, especially if they're temporary, for the greater good, okay? Because if you were on a career track in this organization, okay, if, you know, this was sort of a rite of passage, you're coming up through the ranks, and they're perhaps giving you this duty. I'm assuming this is not the first job you've ever had right out of school. Your career is in progress. Being able to be assigned to things that you may not particularly enjoy, but you get on with it and you make success of it regardless, that is, in a perfect world, that is a rite of passage to become a manager. Okay. You know, any higher level position, occasionally you have to do things that are quite unsavory. For example, firing people or dealing with issues that you don't feel, you know, like you're a particular expert in and you don't feel like you really enjoy it, but it's part of the job. Okay. Now, if you were to quit at the first sign of something you don't really enjoy, you didn't get the picket. In this case, it says you did accept it. So I'm not sure if that means you jumped into it of your own accord, but then didn't like, you know, what it turned into. All the more reason, if this is less than a year, I would say stick it out, if you can stick it out. Because after that, what it's going to do is it's going to demonstrate to people, particularly your boss right now, that, you know, you can deal with things that need to be dealt with, and you can take on challenges that need to be faced, and you're not just going to jump ship the moment things aren't to your liking, okay? That's a requirement of being management material. So I'd say take it, okay? Now, the second part of this is, from a recruitment perspective, what's a reasonable time frame, you know, to commit versus leaving? Now, generally speaking, the way recruiters think, if that's what you're asking about, 2 years is kind of usually traditionally been, at least in, I don't know, since the year 2000, it's been about 2 years. If you work at a place less than, say, 2 years, like maybe 1 year, and then you jump to another job, and then you're there also for 1 year, and then you jump, that's going to be perceived as a red flag. If you are in one place for 2 years, and then you jump to another job and you stay for 2 years, and then you jump to another job and stay for 2 years, generally speaking, that's not going to be regarded as a red flag. Okay. So a lot of weird things have happened in the labor market in the last 6 months. So I'm not sure if that attitude is perhaps changing. But traditionally, 2 years has been the sort of magic number. So if you've been, if you've just accepted it and you still want to put this on your resume, but then disclose that you're only there for a very short amount of time, and that time is less than 2 years, depending on what it is, it could count against you. Okay. If that's the case, I would consider perhaps leaving it off. Or if this is a secondment within an organization that you've been working for a while, I would say, you know, don't list it as a separate job, just list it as a, you know, as a point, like a detail, a line item under that job that you have at that organization. Okay. Or just not mention it at all. And that way it minimizes the risk. Okay. So that's what I would say about that. Hopefully that's helpful to you. Thank you, Darren from Desation, from sending that in. You're awesome. It's always nice when I communicate with people that are listening to this podcast. Thank you very much. You guys are all awesome. Don't forget to check out my courses. I have one called Get Hired, and I have one called the $100 MBA. Okay. And if you haven't heard of that one, that's only been out for less than 2 months, and several people have taken it, and I've heard good things about it. So that's great. Basically, you learn everything that you would learn in a master's of business administration, but you get it from me, and it's not accredited, so you won't get a piece of paper. But the reason for that is because there are no evaluations. You don't have to do any assignments. You don't have to do any tests. All you do is you read the same textbooks you would read in university, learn the same material, and the beauty of it is you can go as deep as you want, or you can skim it if you wish. If you're not interested in a particular subject, you can just skim it. That's fine. It's however deep you want to get into it. It just exposes you to all the material that you would learn in an MBA. And then if you're wanting to start a company or you're wanting to move into management, you can then use that learning to be better at your job. If you want to become a manager, you learn some of the skills to help you be a manager, manage money, manage people, manage projects, manage budgets, et cetera, et cetera. You learn all that. If you want to start a company and be an entrepreneur, it gives you the tools that you will build on to be able to do that. If you want to be in business, it's always great to know business. Invest in yourself, and I have created what I feel is the best bang for the buck. For $100, you could do something that it would cost a lot of people, you know, four or five figures to take this and take 1 or 2 years of their lives full time. So I have given you a way of doing that, a shortcut. I feel it's a shortcut. It's the stuff I wish I knew when I was starting out in my career. Because the other aspect is that depending on what industry you're in, an MBA sometimes is valued, in some industries is valued, in other industries is not. They have this childish notion that you don't need to know business to do business. And as we see, a lot of organizations just run like a dream, let me tell you, especially when they have that attitude. So check that out. There's links to both of those courses in the description box of this video. Thank you so much for listening. I do appreciate you guys. You are all awesome. Let me know if you have any questions, and I will see you on the next episode. Take care.